Don't concentrate on the finger or you will miss all that heavenly glory.
虽则有不平路，磨练得身体与真气正好，将要悉心探讨。龙人笑傲，翻风雨驱云雾，平地一声响彻古今世间，岂有不惊叹号？
世纪巨星李小龙在32岁逝世，他所留下的电影、非凡的武术造诣、独特的人生哲理，实在令人难以忘怀，亦都令全球人士如痴如醉。当年 Bruce 的父亲是粤剧名伶李海泉，他带着太太何爱如远赴美国作巡回演出，因为怀有身孕的关系，何爱如只有暂时留在三藩市那里生活。1940年11月27日，Bruce 就在这间位于唐人埠的积神街医院那里出世。 Bruce 的原名振凡就是当时他妈妈为他而改的，而 Bruce 这个英文名就是一位护士代何爱如女士写上的。由于父亲是梨园大老官的关系， Bruce 至少就已经出入戏棚和片场，虽然李海泉加以阻止，不过 Bruce 的调皮性格实在令父母相当之担心的。大约在1950年，Bruce 就被选中演出《细路巡》一片当上主角了。当时原著漫画家袁步云先生就为他改了一个艺名叫李小龙。少年时候的 Bruce 除了喜欢演戏之外，最喜欢就是联群结党去打交，所以在1953年， Bruce 就拜叶敏宗师学习咏春拳，以增加自己的武功伎俩。之后 Bruce 的街头实战果然连场胜利，不过 Bruce 的学业就不是太理想了，仲要转校继续升学。除了习武之外，少年时候的 Bruce 经常参加派对，他的跳舞技艺亦都非常之出色。不过在18岁的时候， Bruce 父母就担心他的前途问题，决定将他送去美国读书，而 Bruce 亦都开始了他异乡隻身的生活了。西雅图是 Bruce 人生中一个重要的地方，因为他在这里度过了他大学生活，同时展开了他武术的事业。更重要的是， Bruce 在这段时间成家立室，可以说 Bruce 在西雅图度过了一段很开心的日子。
即他一路都是他人是很活泼，一路都是很喜欢周围走，小时候已经是很活很动的那种人。即他又因为他你知道你個阿伯，即係細細個好中意呢度，即係都係稍微做靚仔嘅啫。呢度即係要扮靚啊！呢度即係喺女仔面前係呢度即係有懶有型有款嗰只。咁好多人睇佢唔順眼，咪有人嚟唔打，呢度打幾人都埋打低
嘅圍打。
咁啊，心氣咁啊，把心一橫不如都唔得，大佬呢度即係要學翻啲武術嚟到呢度保護翻佢自己嘅形象。就是等會就算他一路繼續係咁做，都可以不會衰到俾人睇，唔會俾人打低嘅。
咁你話佢嗰陣時喺香港係咪搞好多事出嚟，所以要走咧？
Actually 嗰陣時咁細細個一路都中意，因為佢開始練武。咁啊練武，佢係認為即係一定要係現場認真嘅先學到。咁日日即係咪打交咯？咁打到
攞啲人嚟做練習工具咁樣。
係咯，即係 anyway 都打到成警察局話，即係同學校講，喂，再唔停打交就拉㗎啦 ，OK， 咁變咗你阿爺你阿嫲冇計啊 ，OK， 即係接觸咗佢咪要送去美國，希望住滿環境改變佢呢種，即係呢個想法，即係個心態。
咁佢走嗰時候，你哋咁即係話你啦、阿嫲啦、阿爺會唔會好唔捨得佢咁樣？
即係我你阿爺咧，就一路都係好中國式傳統，即係佢唔係好表示佢嘅心態出嚟好多時，即係好板面嗰種。但係睇得出，即係佢走嘅咯，即係都唔捨得，梗係唔捨得啦，大佬。即係好似你話嗰次翻香港 ，OK， 我都唔捨得，唔通話唔通攬住你喊咩？唔係嗰只啫嘛，即係咗。因為嗰次佢走嘅時候咧，你阿爺俾$100 OK 美金係咁多，
就係咁啊
嚇。咁啊，自生自滅，係啊，自生自滅。咁啊，即係63年翻嚟係佢自己賺錢，賺到翻嚟同埋讀到書，仲買咗禮物送俾你阿爺你阿嫲。
咁你嗰陣時係點樣賺錢？
教人打功夫。
係咩？佢嗰陣時教人打功夫。
係啊，一路教人打功夫啊。
哇！佢喺邊？佢喺 Seattle 嗰時。
喺西雅圖
嘅。喺 Seattle。咁佢係自己自行開咗個地方 rent 咗，咁就租咗個地方嚟。
Actually 嗰陣時佢已經出咗第一本書添。
揾出書
啊？係啊，英文書啊。但係嗰陣時係講詠春嘅，嗰陣時大家就未打住見到啊。
1959年 ，Bruce 由三藩市去到西雅圖投靠一位父親嘅世家 Ruby Chow。仲在他的餐馆做兼职，开始他半工读的生活，同时也在学校课余的活动之中教授交际舞和武术，以帮补生活费，也无需再依赖家人的接济了。半工读的生活虽然是非常辛苦，但是 Bruce 的努力并没有白费。在1961年3月， Bruce 就顺利考入了西雅图华盛顿大学，一边读书一边兼职一边习舞，令 Bruce 的大学生活忙个不停。但是 Bruce 依旧继续教功夫，同时还将他所学的哲理融入武术当中。 Bruce 为他的武术付出一生的心血，而武术亦都令到他得到人生最大的收获，就是认识他的挚爱 Linda 了。 Linda 是 Bruce 的同校生，亦都是他武术班的学生。两人在1964年8月在西雅图这间教堂结婚。1961年期间，身为大学生的 Bruce 并没有放弃他的爱好武术，他继续习武授徒，而且更定下一个目标，就是在美国开设连锁式武馆。 Bruce 对学生的重视和关怀，令到他的学生无怨无悔地为他筹办武馆。在大家的努力之下，1962年4月， Bruce 终于在西雅图的一座旧楼的地牢成功开设他第一间镇藩国术馆。Bruce 不单止对武术和学生们非常重视，对国术馆的每一件事情也都极之认真，就连国术馆的卡片、证书等等都全部是 Bruce 自己亲自设计的。开设了第一间镇藩国术馆之后， Bruce 就更加努力将他的武术和哲学传授给他的学生。他独特的授武方式的确令学生们的水准进步无间。
Well, you know, he told me we have what we call the basics, and we call this Jun Fang Gung Fu. That has a set curriculum in which everyone follows. Then Jeet Kune Do is really Bruce Lee's own personal way of combat, which through research, through creativity, through exploration, and that can be taught, but it cannot be standardized. So he told us everyone had to find their own way to become Jeet Kune Do. Because Jeet Kune Do was, as he said, is your own personal progression through life. And so what we've done, some people have stayed with the original techniques, which are handed down, which I do too. We call that Jun Fang Gung Fu. And then we explore and expand on some of the principles and concepts that he gave us to live by, in other words, you know. One will be, what is the most efficient method? And if we find a more efficient method, which has been very, very little, we put that into the system, but we keep the original things that were handed down.
In the beginning, he had us training very, very rigorously. He had us doing a lot of exercises so we could be prepared to go into the techniques, but he was a very tough taskmaster when it came to teaching. He would make us go through these routines until we were about ready to drop, but of course we were afraid to stop because he might get angry.
Come after you and chase you down.
So we got some good training, you know, not just in exercise, but then we'd go into the techniques, and he was very thorough.
But do you see any progress in Bruce as the training goes along?
Oh, Bruce, when he first came here, he was more into the modified status of Wing Chun, but as he went down into Oakland, into Los Angeles, he went through his own journey of working out with different people, finding the strongest people in the martial arts world, and picking up maybe a little this or that they had that he thought was good, And he was a great believer that the more simplified a system could be, the more realistic it was, because the more complex it became, the more unrealistic it became.
He made out a program for each individual. He would size you up, and he said, like Joe, he says, you have to work on maybe more forearms, or more upper body strength. On your legs, you have to stretch more, see, because my stretching wasn't too good. So he could see an individual and break him down and give him a program for himself that you need to own him.
I know you and Bruce were also friends also after training. Can you tell us any interesting stories that happened during your friendship?
Well, anywhere we would go, when we would socialize, anywhere, he would always say, little Joe, get the book. And you know what that means? No?
No.
Okay. He had something called a two-inch punch. And he would stand in front of someone and put their hand on their chest. And just like that, he would hit them, and it would throw them all the way back.
Wow, so powerful.
Powerful.
Yeah.
So he didn't want to do this on the other person, so he would tell me to get the book. And I didn't want to have any part of that because it hurt.
When he came down to Oakland, then every chance I get, I go to James' house. So we developed a very good friendship, and the chemistry was very good. James is sort of a kung fu, a street fighter type, and I was mostly on the fitness and weight training, and James and I also we both started weight training together, and also we did kung fu together, you know, what little we learned until Bruce came. It changed the whole all the kung fu I learned, I just want to forget it because cannot even use my kung fu. So then that's how we got started in learning, and he taught us a modified Wing Chun. And that's how one of the JK, he was born in Oakland.
Yeah, he'll stand in front of me. He said, blink your heart. When I blink my heart, he's behind me already. That's one thing, I don't know how he did it.
It's amazing.
And to this day, I couldn't believe a man is that fast. And another thing is to two or three inch punch, to knock down a 350 pound, and I've seen it. And a lot of people don't believe that he can do that. Like I said, he's only my size, 140 pounds, and with a punch he did, it's off from the waist. You know, that's all he does. And he knocked him over. No matter how big the man is, it's amazing that how much power a little man like him would have.
咁頭先講起做靶一樣嘢啦，你有冇邊一次做靶係做得最難忘，或者會記得最深刻？呢樣嘢我諗係最難忘咧，就係第一次我到咗大概第二日到啦，就係話呢個即係同佢跑完步翻嚟，午餐食之後，咁啊到晏晝食完飯，喂，咁啊佢有嗰啲，你知美國打籃球你都知啦，你嗰時候考啦。有啲football shield嗰啲咧，有啲差唔多類似盔甲咁樣嘅，唔係，即係嗰啲膠做咁幫你保護你身體。唔係，嗰啲啊，嗰啲唔係，成揸住嘅，係泵咗氣，你咁樣揸住，譬如有人撞埋你，你又嚟擋嗰只，咁佢話揸住一個，
大大嗰啲膠，類似
即係有啲泵咗氣，冧啊嘛，咁我揸住個落嚟喎，咁我喺草地度，喺個後院好似呢個草地咁啊，咁佢行，睇下大概離開我6-7尺到啦。
一衝行一個中文，我唔知點叫，side kick，唔橫踢咁樣。當時我一接觸到佢踢我嘅時候咧，休克咗大概半秒到，跟住一醒翻嘅時候已經知道離開飛開咗離開大概5-6尺到喺地下度瞓咗。咁我以為哇大佬，我睇嗰時百零幾磅嘅，我話哇好勁喎好勁，咁啊佢已經係覺得好勁，因為突然間好似俾一隻馬掹埋嚟咁樣嘅。 但係收尾咁啊，跟住係個周末，咁佢徒弟過嚟，咁有幾個徒弟，咁咪6-200磅，又係一樣同樣做一樣嘢，又係咁樣雙腳離地飛起，又係離開幾尺，200磅人又一樣咁飛，又係咁樣啦。所以即係鬼佬嚟講，即係佢話
端磅計，即係佢嘅功力打出嚟係根本係超人。
Bruce 努力受武嘅成果，令到佢開始受人注意同埋熟悉。除咗有更多更多人慕名而嚟跟佢學武之外，亦都好多人開始邀請佢作武術演出。經過多次嘅小型表演之後 ，Bruce 終於得到一個令佢武術事業有極大突破嘅機會。喺1964年8月2日 ，Bruce 被國際空手道周年冠軍賽主辦人艾伯加邀請到長堤作示範表演。
In my father's opinion, he thought Bruce, pound for pound, was the best fighter in the world at the time. Yeah, I wouldn't put him against Andre the Giant at the time. You know, he's small, but for his size and for his abilities, my father thought he was the most talented man on the planet at the time.
Why did he use him at the first international?
Well, at the first internationals, he really wanted to spotlight the importance of martial arts and to make sure that it was a place where enough of the different stylists, the Japanese, Korean, the Chinese and the American stylists, and bringing them together in one place to spotlight their talents and abilities. And he thought that the best way to demonstrate the versatility and the talent is to put the most talented people in for demonstration. And one of those people.
上眼，单靠手部的触觉同对手作互相攻击，凭小龙的表现里面可以看得出小龙手部的灵敏度是相当之高的。经过几项示范之后，小龙继续向观众讲解他将要示范的其他武技。对于在场的习武人士来讲，小龙这套这么突破性和有创意的武术理论实在深深地吸引着他们，可见小龙在武术方面的确有摄人的魅力。最后，小龙要示范的就是同对手对打时候的拳脚功夫了。 小龙以佢快而强劲嘅脚法，好轻易咁就将对手击倒，令到对手毫无还击之力。小龙再一次示范佢嘅脚法，呢一项快而劲嘅脚法功夫表演，为小龙带嚟全场嘅喝彩声以及赞美声。另一项惊人的示范就是无影拳，小龙指明攻击对手哪一个部位就可以拳拳打中，可以想象得到小龙出拳时候极之眼明手快，甚至是无迹可寻。小龙这次精彩的示范和讲解令到在场每一个人都叹为观止，同时主办人艾柏加亦都将小龙这次长提示范表演的片段送到美国著名电视片的导演手上。这次的示范最大的影响就是为小龙开拓了荷里活银色事业的第一步。在1965年终于有机会参加电视剧《青蜂侠》的演出。1965年2月1日 ，Linda 为小龙诞下第一个儿子李国豪，英文名叫 Brandon。同时期，小龙终于得到第一个演出的机会，在美国霍士公司拍摄的电视剧《青蜂侠》入面，扮演青蜂侠的助手加藤的角色。小龙一直对荷里活充满憧憬。1966年，小龙就将一家人搬去洛杉矶那里生活，开始他的银色事业。还在唐人街开设新的武馆。小龙非常痛锡儿子国豪，在国豪只得两岁的时候，小龙就亲自教他踢脚和出拳，而国豪亦都秉承了父亲的优良血统，自小对武术和演戏都十分之有兴趣，令到国豪在日后亦都成为荷里活其中一位影星。直到1969年4月， Linda 为小龙再诞下一个女儿，叫做香盈 Shannon。 小龙钻研独创武术门派，不断创新改良换春，甚至研究拳击剑击等等，务求找出更完美的改良，称之为截拳道。而截拳道中的武学理念就是以无法为有法，以无限为有限。小龙主张以无法为有法，以无限为有限，真意就是要学武者明白到武术原本就是没有任何门派，亦都没有好与不好之分，要功夫好一定要持之以恒，不断进步，招式亦都不重要，思想才是最重要的。小龙将他精心创立的截拳道和武学哲理教授给每一个学生，令每一位学生在武术上都得到更大的发展。直至今日，小龙这套独特的武学理念同样启发了后世无数的朋友，所以截拳道可以说是李小龙一生最大的成就和贡献。
Yeah, he was very unpredictable in this event, because sometimes I would go there to train really hard, in other words, to get a very cardio workout, mm-hmm. and sometimes we'd go out there and it wouldn't be a cardio workout, it would be a lecture on philosophy and why we were studying the martial arts and the purpose of it. So in that way, he was like, you have to expect sometimes a philosophical type of workout, and sometimes it would be very, very cardiovascular or muscular type of workout. He loved to experiment. He loved to research other martial arts, and sometimes he would have me do other martial arts at him so he could see what was the strengths and weaknesses of different martial arts. He would show me that, well, this is the way sometimes praying mantis, southern mantis attacks, and sometimes this is the way of northern mantis, or this is the way Choi fought, and let's find out some of the strengths and weaknesses of each. And I think that's what made him really unique. So for me, it was really educational, because I began to kind of appreciate a little bit of every system, because they have, as he calls, advantage and disadvantages, strengths and weaknesses also.
Well, I was humbled, because I always felt that, you know, that I really didn't have much to offer him. You know, he could have just passed over me and just gone to the next step, which he did physically, but he never forgot me. You know, I have letters, you know, he wrote to me at least once a month, and he was after he left here, and kept me informed of what he was doing, the kind of ideas that he had, the progress he was making, and many, many letters that showed some discouragement, because the project that he was working on were, he never gave up. I mean, he was always, I don't know how many times letters he sent me where the project failed, but before the letter ended, he was already telling me about the next project he was working on. And so that's been a very strong, strong teaching, you know, feeling for me, because, you know, I think there's not a one of us that goes through life without a lot of strife and negativeness and fear and all these things. But, you know, it's up to you. Are you going to give up, or are you going to keep going? And that's one of the things that I learned from Bruce, that we have to just keep going, you know.
He would say, before I learned Kung Fu, a tree was a tree, a bowl was a bowl. Now that I am spreading Kung Fu, a tree is no longer a tree. A bowl is not a bowl.
Mm-hmm.
Now that I have mastered Kung Fu, a tree is a tree, a bowl is a bowl.
Mm.
Which means when you first start to learn something,
yes.
someone will say, here, catch this ball. They throw it to you, and you just catch it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You didn't think about it.
Mm-hmm.
But then they say, okay, now you're going to be a baseball player, and I'm going to throw the ball to you. Plant your feet, put your body in this position, put your hands like that, and catch. See, you have to think about it.
Mm-hmm.
But now,
step by step.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Now that you've been playing baseball or whatever for a long, long time,
mm-hmm.
they throw you the ball, you don't even think about it, you catch it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the way when you master something, as I do with cutting hair, I don't have to think about it. It just happens.
Mm-hmm.
The same with Bruce, his art. He mastered it, so he never had to think about anything. He just did it.
There's a person so young, and when he talked, you listen, you know. And the way he talked about philosophy, like what real life is, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And some people can go through life and go through a lot of problem, and sometimes he can solve that certain thing without avoiding all these problems, you know, because we make our own problem, you know, actually.
Yes.
Think. So if you can see it ahead of time, and we always listen to him when he comes to my house. We always have dinner which ready, because we just want to listen to him to just talk, you know. And then when he talked, everybody listened.
All the equipment that pertained to his body, in other words, he really think a lot of his body. You don't think anything, he don't drink or smoke, but he think a lot about that, all this equipment I made for him. And he was happy with it. And like I say, he designed it and I make it. Constantly drawing things, like even the nunchucks, you know.
Yeah.
And his kicking shield for him to kick. He designed a lot of time, I make it, he's not satisfied, it's too small or too big. not enough foam. So we went through that for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. And even when he went to the, he got to Hollywood for the Green Hornet, he still sending me a letter and then a sketch thing. I said, can you make something like that? So I did it for him. And mm-hmm. it's just what I learned from him, he kind of changed my life a little. Mm-hmm. And all the kung fu that I used to learn in China, forget it. His is so precise. Mm-hmm. So it's perfect. I would say that what you learn from him is nothing more to learn, mm-hmm. as far as I'm concerned. Yeah.
清风侠之后，小龙的电影事业阻滞重重，只好回香港发展。不过在1971年，小龙受到香港电影人周文怀的赏识，邀请拍摄《唐山大兄》一片。之后，《精武门》、《猛龙过江》一系列的李小龙功夫电影都屡创佳绩，令到小龙一时声名大噪。在1972年年底，美国华纳电影公司就派摄制人员专程来香港，为小龙拍摄《龙争虎斗》一片。
Well, I mean, one of the things I remember is that the first day we shot with Bruce, he had avoided it for a couple of days. He was just sort of building himself up to it, and he was very nervous. He was very nervous, and we decided we wouldn't shoot the scene we had planned. We took something where he wouldn't have to do much, and the very first scene we shot was where he was sitting in his room on Hans Island, mm-hmm. and they paraded the girls in, because he didn't have to do anything except to nod.
Just look at the girls, huh?
Yeah. And the minute we got over the first couple of takes, he was mm-hmm. fine. And from then on, I mean, he got so involved in it, then after we finished shooting, he had some other ideas, and he kept shooting himself. And some of it we used. I mean, some mm-hmm. of it was marvelous little bits of things that he put in.
Mm-hmm. 李小龙武打电影的成功，不单止将中国功夫发扬光大，更令他成为美国一位超级巨星。不过在1973年7月20日，一个令人难以置信、令人痛心疾首的消息，轰动了国际。李小龙突然昏迷。送院后不治逝世，享年32岁。
咁其实当佢过身嗰阵时候，你嗰阵时系因为系嘛？
1973年一，我仲记得嗰日，我刚同阿爸去出去买唱盘，嗰时仲兴放胶碟嗰啲嘢。
吓，
因为买完翻屋企，好似仲住 apartment， 玻璃咁啊拎入去，放低，跟住电话响。咁啊，我接電話嘅，係我個同學打俾我。佢喂，有冇睇電視啊？佢你大佬死咗嚇。我呢個條友好中意講笑。我唔係啊嘛，佢講笑講揾第二樣嘅，唔好咁。唔係啊，因為我寫美國，你知啦，到依家都係4:00、5:00、6:00有新聞，咁先係4:00嘅啦。咁佢唔信你開嚟睇啊。咁跟住佢收咗線。咁嗰陣時我都唔敢話俾你阿嫲聽，我話死啦，唔知真定假，真係開嚟睇。咁嗰陣時佢又喺廳，我又喺廳，一睇真係你個新聞講出嚟，咁梗係即刻喊啦。咁我都打個突咯，咁啊即刻打先，嗰陣時打俾阿佢阿打俾阿嫂啫，所以我太太。咁係嗰陣時好亂啊，睇先嗰陣時，即係心情好亂。咁你阿嫲又喺度喊，亦都講唔到乜嘢出去。咁係我問我喂，咁使唔使我哋翻嚟？咁你阿嫂話唔使喎。
你阿嫂？
阿咩嘢？唔好意思，即係我自己諗翻轉頭，即係阿嫂就係佢就話，佢話我哋會將個遺體送去西雅圖，喺西雅圖見，就係咁。即係咁打突，即係
好快，你根本冇遇到，
點會諗到就諗一諗。
小龙的葬礼在香港举行，万人空巷，一同追悼这位国际武术巨星。其后小龙的遗孀 Linda 将小龙的遗体送到位于西雅图美丽而宁静的华盛顿湖畔安葬。每年小龙的学生和大量的追随者都会亲自来到小龙的墓前凭吊一番， 以表他们对这一位一代武术宗师和国际巨星的怀念。小龙的儿子国豪在1993年因为拍摄电影乌鸦一片意外身亡，而国豪的墓碑亦都安葬于父亲的墓地旁边。
Bruce Lee was a thinker. He was a researcher. He was very creative, and he was the type of person that could look ahead and say, "Okay, this is the weakness and strength of that system, and we shouldn't follow it blindly just because it's been handed down from generation to generation, generation." And that was very unusual at the time period, and many people questioned it. Even myself, I questioned it, because I always believed that, you know, when you started with a system, you stayed in that system and you follow it to the letter. Mm-hmm. And Bruce Lee says, no, we should question it, improve it.
He passed away. He's being remembered, more importantly, as a great philosopher. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where the essence of his image should be and is that I think all of us are brought into this world to leave a legacy behind us. Mm-hmm. If you do not leave a legacy behind us, that means that you have not completed your journey properly. But what I'm trying to do here is to try to help these people to become more understanding of themselves so that they can leave a legacy behind them.
He was appealing.
Mm-hmm.
And he was so direct.
Mm-hmm.
No wasted movements. Simplicity.
Mm.
And that appealed to me.
Mm-hmm.
Bruce changed my life quite a bit there. He's such a person that he goes around about way, but he hints certain things to you and certain way of philosophy, how you should live mm-hmm. your life and change to a better way of living, you know?
Mm-hmm.
A more simplistic way of life instead of...
He made shortcut out of long cut. Everything is on the center line. Nothing, no waste of motion of a movement. Everything is so precise. I think that's about it as far as martial arts is concerned. It's perfect.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's way ahead of his time. I think he got martial art sold up as far as I'm concerned. He's a master of it.
講真的，我身為佢嘅侄，我自己都覺得好 proud， 我可以有個咁嘅 uncle， 一個咁嘅世紀英雄，一個過咗身咁耐，但係佢個名字差唔多全世界冇一個人會唔知咯。咁你自己身為佢細佬，咁你有咩 feeling towards 有咩感覺咧？
我覺得佢最偉大嘅就係佢嘅精神，
嗯，
可以流傳到依家。即今時今日，無論係幾細個嘅細路仔。你講起武術或者功夫，第一答案就係李小龍 Bruce Lee， 即係好難得一樣嘢，即係佢可以俾人感受到佢嘅精神，直至到今時今日。咁我亦都覺得呢個精神係永遠都會流傳落去，
好難得嘅，
係永久嘅呢個精神。
嗯，
你呢樣嘢應該學。
荷里活星光大道是引证无数荷里活巨星的成就和贡献的地方。在这条大道上面，纪念星辉加上手印、脚印大约有2000多个，而每个的设立都为了表扬每一颗荷里活巨星的成就。在1993年4月28日，接近李小龙逝世20周年的日子，小龙终于成为第1982位获得在星光大道上面镶嵌纪念星辉荣誉的巨星。纪念星辉不单止引证了小龙的成就，亦都肯定了小龙在美国影坛超级巨星的地位。在荷里活另一个角落，有一幅著名的巨星壁画，上面画了无数荷里活巨星的肖像。在云云的肖像当中，我们同样可以找到小龙的画像。可想而知，美国朋友对小龙十分之爱戴和敬重，在他们每一个人的心目中， 小龙实在占有一个非常重要的地位。小龙逝世至今已经超过28年，世人对小龙这位巨星并未遗忘，甚至更加仰慕崇拜。无数的小龙迷和爱好者更以收藏小龙的物品来到怀念他。其中一个在三藩市举行的李小龙回顾展里面，小龙遗孀 Linda 他的学生和数位收藏家就将超过240件极具代表性而珍贵的小龙物品作展出，当中包括小龙的亲笔日记、信件、绘画和哲学作品。除此之外，还有小龙拍摄电影时候穿着过的衣服和用过的武器。除了美国，小龙迷可以说遍布世界各地，更不断举办各种活动来到纪念他。
Jeff, I hear you're one of the biggest Bruce Lee collectors. When did you start collecting?
Well, I started collecting back in 1972. Yeah, long time ago, at the age of 11. Actually, I like to collect everything that I see that might not be possible because I don't have all the money to spend on Bruce Lee. So I try to see what looks nice and... And I just try to add as much to my collection as possible.
Right over here are some examples of some of the business cards that Bruce Lee had produced back in the 1960s.
Yes.
And Bruce Lee was a perfectionist. He would experiment with different colors, different designs until he got the perfect one. It's kind of like his kung fu training, that he would keep training until he got it perfect. This is a book that Bruce wrote in 1963, and it's been autographed by him. Okay, it's kind of falling apart because it's so old, but Bruce wrote a book in 1963 called Chinese Kung Fu, The Philosophical Art of Self-Defense. And it was a very limited edition book. Only 500 copies were made. And my copy here was autographed by Bruce. As you can see right here.
Yes.
And he also signed his Chinese nickname, Long, which is Dragon. This is from 1967. It's the very first martial arts magazine that had Bruce Lee on the cover. So this magazine is pretty historic because as of today, Bruce has been in thousands and thousands of covers of martial arts magazines. So this is very special in my collection.
So I was back in 1964 when I started attending Franklin High School. Bruce and Taky came to one of our high school assemblies to do a demonstration on Kung Fu. And of course, you know, back then I was a sophomore and we all assembled in the gymnasium. And the first thing Bruce did when he walked into the gymnasium was to ask for the toughest fighters in the school to come down and throw some punches at him. Well, back then when you're in high school, you always knew who the best fighters were. And there was a lot of strong inner city street kids that knew how to box and fight. So, you know, we called out their names and told them to go down. And of course, they went down there thinking, oh yeah, well, I'll show this guy up. And Bruce was standing in front of him and said, well, go ahead, throw your best punch at me. And these guys started throwing punches. And I was so amazed to see somebody move that fast. And Bruce was able to intercept all their punches and completely get away from them and control all their movements. And that's when I was just totally mesmerized by his talent.
So what kind of things do you collect on Bruce Lee?
I collect just about everything. I think most collectors now, the core of their collection revolves around buying magazines, books, action figures. I think right now his image is just about on everything that you can imagine. Mugs, stamps. It's very easy to put his image on anything and everything. So I try to restrict my collection to more of his personal artifacts now.
Lonely Sunday, 情是注定，要此生 变得丰盛。
李小龙一生引人入胜，令人不思量，自难忘。他的武术和哲学更为后世人带来无穷的启示。
无论世界每日每时变幻不定，存在我心中只有他的姓名。豪情流传万世，学会理想坚定，唯愿这心声他都可再听。懂得声难计算动静，连环动作顷刻可制胜，刹那间使出全劲，当中的威力强劲。无论世界每日每时变幻不定，存在我心中只有他的姓名。情流传万世，学会理想坚定，唯愿这心声他都可再听。
云雾，平地一声响彻。
去方感到的失陷参跌卧倒
在泪光感到的身陷参跌卧倒